Hi, this is Alok Shukla from IIT Bombay, and next I'll start my presentation in the screen sharing mode. The title of my talk is Theory of Electronic and Optical Properties of Pristine and Defective Graphene Quantum Dots, and the collaborators in this work are Teesta Basak, Tushima Basak, and Pritam Bhattacharya. And I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to deliver this talk. We all know that pure graphene is a gapless two-dimensional semiconductors, but most optoelectronic applications will require a gap. As a result, over the years, lots of research has been done to create the so-called gapped graphene. And approaches used have been chemical modification, adsorption of foreign atoms, quantum confinement, etc. Examples of quantum confined structures of graphene are nano ribbons and quantum dots. Nano ribbons are 1D periodic structures, while quantum dots are 0D. So in our group, we have performed several calculations over the years on graphene, nano ribbons, and quantum dots. And here we present some of those calculations or results of some of those calculations. So what do graphene quantum dots look like? Here I'm showing a few, or rather four, symmetric graphene quantum dots. They have triangular structure, hexagonal structure, or diamond-shaped structure, and their edges can be zigzag, armchair, or some mixtures thereof. And one can also come up with the graphene quantum dots of irregular and totally asymmetric shapes, and also with edge structure which doesn't fall in any of the well-defined categories in addition to the regular ones. So as a result, one can probe the influence of symmetry on their electro-optical properties by considering quantum dots of different symmetries. And we know that in reduced dimensions, electron correlation effects are also enhanced. So by studying these quantum dots, we can study the combined influence of a lot of effects, such as disorder, correlation, quantum confinement, etc. Okay, a few basic general comments. Pure graphene, carbon-based graphene quantum dots will have dangling bonds at the edges. However, quantum dots with passivated edges, and passivation may be by hydrogen or some other functional group, normally retain a planar symmetric structure. So hydrogen-saturated structures are called polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons in organic chemistry and are basically pi-conjugated molecules. In such systems, the low-lying excitations are mainly due to pi electrons. In our calculations, we assume that all the graphene quantum dots have passivated edges. As a result, we can compare our calculations with the corresponding experimental results on polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And because we assume that these materials are pi electron materials, so we use the effective pi electron Hamiltonian called PPP model, which was proposed by Pariser, Parr, and Popel in 1963 in our calculations. And it has been used extensively in chemistry for studying such aromatic molecules. Okay, so what does PPP model look like? This equation gives us precisely that. On the left-hand side, we have three terms. The first term is the tight binding term. The second one is the on-site repulsion. And third one is the long-range Coulomb repulsion. And it is written in terms of, in second quantized notation. So creation and annihilation operators are used, which are all defined here. The most important thing to note is that this Hamiltonian has unknown parameters or adjustable parameters called hopping, the Coulomb on-site repulsion, and the long-range Coulomb repulsion. Now the question is, what values should we use for them? For hopping, normally one uses, just like in Huckel model, one uses the nearest neighbor hopping with the T to be 2.4 eV for carbon-based systems, while for Coulomb interaction, long-range Coulomb interaction, one uses the ONO parameterization defined by this equation, which depends upon the Hubbard U value, a dielectric constant, and the distance. Okay, and it roughly goes as 1 over square root of the distance between the electrons located on atoms I and j. Okay, and for Hubbard U, in the standard set of parameters, the value 11.13 EV is used, but we found that the values, lower values proposed by Chandros and Mazumdar in 1997, corresponding to U is equal to 8 EV, gives us better results for our systems. So therefore, we have used them frequently. The computational approach which we use involves performing the Hartree-Fock calculations, and we obtain the molecular orbitals. For the purpose, we use a code developed in our own group, while electron correlation effects, if needed, are calculated by performing configuration interaction calculations at various levels of approximation, such as full CI, quadruple CI, or M multi-reference singles and double CI, depending upon the size of the system. Okay, and a few, we are listing five recent applications of our approach to study various phenomena in quantum dots of different shapes. While in this presentation, I'll restrict myself to last two papers, which are also the most recent ones. The first of these involves study of optical absorption in lower symmetry polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, while the last one involves the modification of optical properties of graphene quantum dots due to the presence of topological stone veils defects. Okay, so let us go to the first of these. Here we studied, in this paper, we studied coronene derivatives, and which have lower symmetry as compared to the parent molecule coronene, which has D6H symmetry. And it is obvious from the TOC figure here that symmetry modifies the optical absorption spectra of molecules significantly. Actually, in this paper, we studied four coronene derivatives, okay, three of which, and they are shown here, and three of which have C2B symmetry, first three of those, and the last one has no symmetry at all. And in all the calculations, we assumed uniform bond lengths of 1.4 angstroms and uniform bond angles of 120 degrees, which are quite reasonable for planar hydrocarbons. And we used MRSD CI approach with CI matrix sizes ranging from 600,000 to 6 million, which is quite large scale. So we believe that our calculations are quite accurate. Let us go to the results which we obtain on the so-called homoluma gap or the optical gap. Okay, and we have experimental results available for benzo A coronene and NAFTO 812 ABC coronene. And if we compare our results, theoretical results obtained at various levels of theory, okay, then we see that tight binding model gives the worst agreement with the experimental results. It underestimates them very severely. The Hartree-Fock calculations performed using screen parameters are somewhat better, okay, but they are overshooting the optical gap. The ones using standard parameters are way above the experimental values, while our CI calculations, as expected, performed using both the sets of parameters are in much better agreement with the experiments, and particularly those performed using the screen parameters. In addition, we note that for the first three structures with the increasing size, the gap is decreasing independently of the model employed and the calculational method used. And as I have already mentioned, that the RHF gaps are much larger as compared to those computed by other methods. Let us look at the optical absorption spectra of benzo A coronene calculated using the standard parameters and the screen parameters. In all our calculations using both the parameters, the first peak is predicted to be Y polarized, okay, that is perpendicular to the conjugation direction, so to speak, okay, and it is dominated by homolumo excitation, while the second peak is the most intense peak, okay, and it is dominated by homo to lumo plus one and homo minus one to lumo excitations. Okay, then here we present the calculated spectra for naphtho 812 ABC coronene, the molecule with the lowest symmetry, that is no symmetry at all. Okay, here this particular molecule, again we have very good agreement with the experimental results. As far as our screen parameter calculations are concerned, again the first peak is dominated by homo-lumo transition, and the most intense peak with the screen parameters calculations is second peak is the most intense peak is due to homo to lumo plus one and homo minus one to lumo transition. And here is a comparison of our calculated peak positions with the experimental results, not just for the lowest peak corresponding to homo lumo, but higher peaks also. And again, we see that we have very good agreements with the experimental results. Okay. And here for both the molecules, you can compare individual peaks. Okay. And the experimental data is taken from the paper of Bagley et al. Okay, so this completes the story on lower symmetry pHs. Now we move on to the stone veil defected rectangular quantum dots. So this work was published in Physical Review B only recently. And the motivations for this study are that pristine GQDs, that is quantum dots, cannot be used to design efficient visible light harvesting devices. The reason is that they absorb poorly in the visible light. So the question is, can one enhance light absorption in the visible range in GQDs by introducing topological defects such as stone veils defect? And then what is the influence of these defects on the optical properties of GQDs? Okay, so let us get on with this. Here we, in this particular work, we studied three systems. On the left, we have a rectangular quantum dot, which we call GQD64, containing 64 carbon atoms. And in the middle, we have the same quantum dot with the same number of atoms, except that now the quantum dot contains a stone veils defect, that is heptagon type of defect on one of the edges. While on the rightmost quantum dot has the same number of atoms, but it has the stone veils defect in the middle. Okay, so here is the stone veils defect, heptagon, pentagon. Okay, and we optimize the geometries of the three quantum dots at first principles Hartree-Fock level using the Gaussian program. And we found, as expected, that the pristine quantum dot had the lowest energy, while the one on the with the stone veils defect on the edge has next higher energy, and the one in the with the stone veils defect in the middle has the highest energy. Okay, so we call SW1 as the stone veil defective quantum dot with the rect zag edge, that is reconstructed edge, while the one in the core, the one with the stone veils defect in the core, is called SW2 GQD64. Okay, so let us study in brief the results obtained for the homo-lumo gap of all the three structures at various levels of theory. At tight binding level of theory, for the three quantum dots, we get very low optical gaps as compared to Hartree-Fock theory or configuration interaction theory. And these calculations, the PPP model calculations, were performed using the screen parameters. Okay, and we see that there is a clear-cut trend when we compare PPPHF and PPPCI results. That is, they are well correlated here. Okay, let us look at the optical absorption spectra of the three quantum dots calculated using the PPPCI approach. And the noteworthy point is that for the pristine quantum dot, the intensity of the first peak is very high, while for defective quantum dots, the intensity of the first peak, which also corresponds to the homo-lumo peak, homo-lumo peak in the pristine quantum dot, but H2L plus Y, 1 and H minus 1 to L peak for the defective quantum dots, So the intensity of the lower energy peaks has reduced considerably in the defective quantum dots. However, there are a large number of peaks in the lower energy region. Okay. So, because of that, what happens is that when we calculate the absorption percentage of the total absorption spectrum in the visible domain for the pristine quantum dot, we have 59% of the absorption spectrum is lying in that domain, while with the SW1 structured defective quantum dot, 65% of the total CI absorption spectrum is in the visible domain. But most interestingly, with the quantum dot with the Stone-Weyl's defect in the middle, which was the highest energy quantum dot, here we have 83% of the absorption spectrum is in the visible domain. This is very interesting. So we believe that by introducing Stone-Weyl defects, we can shift the absorption spectrum in the visible domain and use these devices. I mean, if such devices can be made, use these devices such that they can be operated in the visible range of the light. Okay, finally, we have the summary and the outlook of the talk. So we perform PPP model-based calculations. Electron correlation effects were included in the method. Approach is efficient and yields results in good agreement with the experiments. Applied for the first time to study the optical properties of defective quantum dots. Important predictions made regarding the absorption spectra of defective quantum dots, that is shifting to the visible domain. First principles approaches would have been too expensive and slow. Non-linear optical properties such as third harmonic generation and two photon absorption are also being computed, and we will publish that in future. And we are very much open to collaborate with other theoreticians and experimenters in this particular field. And finally, my collaborators in this work over the years, Sumit Mazumdar is from University of Arizona. Himanshu Chakravarti is my former PhD student. Tista is a former postdoc and a collaborator. Tushima, a collaborator. Preetam, a former student, now a postdoc in IFW Dresden. And my research has been funded by DST and Indo-US Science and Technology Forum over the years. Thank you very much for your attention.